Well, this morning I want to teach about Hanukkah, what it means. And this event is not mentioned in the Old Testament. And in our Bible, in the Jewish Bible, they have what is known as the Torah, the books of Moses. We've incorporated all the writings of the Old Testament. We have the New Testament since Jesus came. And we also believe that there was the Old Covenant, and then Jesus brought in a New Covenant for us to follow. But this isn't written. Hanukkah is not in the Old Testament because it took place during the 400 years between the two Testaments. There was 400 years span between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And so this took place during that time period. But what's interesting, as we'll hear a little bit later, is that this was being observed in the time of Jesus. And actually, Jesus went to the temple and observed Hanukkah. Hanukkah is a story, and it's recounted in Maccabees. Now, Maccabees is a book that's in the Apocrypha. We don't have it in our canon, and I don't want to get too over, but let's just say it's religious writings of that time. And it's pulled out of, in Maccabees, about the Jewish holiday of Hanukkah. And it's in the month of Kislev. And again, the Jewish calendar is different, you know, than we follow a Roman calendar. They follow the lunar calendar, and it's different in different days. And so it falls on different days. Their Hanukkah falls sometimes between November and December, somewhere in there. But it's dating back to the second century before Christ when they started observing that. And it was 167 years before Christ that the Greek king Antiochus, thank you. I need you next to me all the time, began to persecute the Jewish people. And what I loved, I said, man, I'm gonna botch some of these words. And Abe said, don't worry, they won't know. You know, so I said, I do it every week. They know. But this Greek king came in and persecuted the Jewish people. And he forbid circumcision. He burned the Jewish scriptures. He tore them all up, and he forced the Jews to eat unclean swine's flesh, and he desecrated the temple, and so much so that they put a swine, an unkosher sacrifice, on the altar and completely devastated even how the Jews worshipped in that temple. It was a terrible, terrible thing that took place. Horrified by the sacrilege, an elderly priest by Mattathias, close enough, and his son Judah Maccabees. He actually had five sons, but Judah Maccabees was kind of like the key man. And they formed a militia, and they waged war, a guerrilla warfare tactics against the occupying Greek forces. I mean, they were just small in number against a mighty foe, but they were to prevail. And if it was said of Judah Maccabees, as he called an army together, he said, every man who has zeal for the law and maintains the covenant, let him follow me. And so they led a revolution, and they were able to succeed, and the temple was rededicated in 164 B.C. on the 24th day of Kislev. And the word for Hanukkah and the celebration of that, it means dedication, because they dedicated the temple. Other words that were used as for dedication and Hanukkah was cleansed, restored, reconsecrated. Also, you'll find this time, this festival, written in some of the commentaries under the Festival of Lights because of the lighting of the eight candles, and I'll go into that just a little bit. There are two stories or two ways of why they celebrate Hanukkah lasting 8 days. And one of the things I've read up on was that the Feast of Hanukkah lasted 8 days because Judas Maccabees wanted to imitate King Solomon, who built that temple. And Solomon had dedicated the original temple during the 8 days Feast of Tabernacles. But the Feast of Tabernacles fell in the month of Tishra, and that was 10 months following. And so that was too long to wait. It was too far away. And so he decided he'd make it at this time, and he made a decree for the new 8-day festival to be created in a kind of imitation of the Festival of the Tabernacles. And you can find that in 2 Maccabees. But anyway, the other tradition that Jewish is in the Jewish Talmud, and offers another tradition to explain the 8 days of Hanukkah. When the Jews recaptured Jerusalem from the Greeks, the Jewish priests did not have enough oil to keep the temple's menorah lit. And so they were able to find a little bit of oil because it was completely destroyed and demolished. And there's only enough sacred oil to burn for one day, and would last actually the whole week. And one day at a time, it just lasted for 8 days for the time that they were there. And for this reason, they recognized the 8 candles lit on the menorah during the 8 days of the festival. In 1 John 10, and we're going to be looking at that there, we're going to see, and a lot of Christians don't realize, that Jesus actually went to the temple, and it was a key point in him opening up and telling, okay, who I am and what his ministry was going to be about. And in John 10, we're going to be looking at some different scriptures, and hopefully they'll be able to follow me on there, starting with verse 22. But many Christians are aware of these connections. In the Gospel of John, Christ comes to the temple during Hanukkah. It is important because Hanukkah recalled how the Maccabees dedicated the temple after the Greeks defiled it. But here, but it's said that the presence of God did not manifest itself at the rededication of the Maccabees like it did in the time of King Solomon. In the time of King Solomon, the presence of God was there in the tabernacle in the Holy of Holies. But it is said that at this time it didn't take place. Scholars have said that when Jesus arrived there in the temple, the presence of Christ in that temple at Hanukkah showed that God's presence had once again entered into that temple. And the Feast of Dedication, Hanukkah, was at Jerusalem. It was wintertime. And they're confronted in John 10, and some of them are asking, and it starts with verse 22, how long will you keep us in suspense? They're asking Jesus. If you're the Christ, then tell us openly. And for he was trying to avoid, there was unrest. There was a lot of the Roman occupancy was going around then, and they were feeling that he was going to rise up and take over leadership. You had the religious leaders that felt like he was leading a coup and an uprising, and he tried to dispel all of that because that wasn't his purpose or his reason. But all of a sudden, he boldly proclaimed for the first time at the time of Hanukkah in that he said that verse 30, it says, I and the Father are one. Christ entered into the temple at this feast, and he presented himself for the first time that I am God and one. His enemies immediately stood up against his claim, and they took up stones, and they tried to stone him. In John 10, 31 through 33, he says, we stone you for blasphemy, because you, being man, make yourself to be God. And so the festival of Hanukkah serves as a sign of Christ's fulfillment of the temple to enter as a fulfillment of the entire Old Testament and the Old Covenant. He was coming to say that I fulfilled the purpose of the covenant that was given. Jesus was not only a gifted rabbi from Nazareth, but now he's making a claim that he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And no wonder there was a rise, and they tried to stone him at that time. Jesus the Messiah brought even a greater deliverance than Judas Maccabees could ever give. He delivers not only for a time, but we say that Jesus delivered for an eternity. It wasn't just for a moment or a time or a place, an event, but it was for all history, for all time, for all people. Jesus is also the prophet who Moses spoke of in Deuteronomy 18, 15. It says, the Lord your God will rise up for you a prophet like me among your own brothers. You must listen to him, for this is what you asked of the Lord your God the day that you assembled. And you said, let us not hear the voice of the Lord our God, nor see this great fire anymore, or he will die. And the Lord said to me, what they say is good. I will rise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. If anyone does not listen to my words that the prophet speaks in my name, I myself will call him to account. In Acts, when it was recounting this, and the book of Acts was recorded, that this is that Moses who told the Israelites, God will send you a prophet like me from your own people. He is also the anointed and the anointed king. We look at Jesus and we say he's a prophet, king, and our Savior. Prophet, king, and priest, a lot of times we will say. And in John 4, 25 through 26, the woman said, I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus declared, and this is the first time, I who speak to you am he. In John 10, 29 and 30, it's recorded saying, my Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch him out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. And so here he's for the first time again proclaiming about who he is and why he came and that he and the Father was one. Just a couple months earlier than this, Jesus declared in John 8, 12, he says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but he shall have the light of life. Interesting with the menorah candles that represent light, that Jesus says, I come and I represent light. Soon after, Jesus gave light to the man that was born blind. He testifies to a greater symbolism that the light of the Lord is shining on those who are spiritually blind. In Isaiah, the Hebrew prophet spoke of the coming true light, and he says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness will cover the earth, and the deep darkness of the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Christ is a true light that gives light to all who believe on him. He is the light of life. In Luke 2:32, it says that he is the light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of the people Israel. Even back then, they connected the Gentiles and those who were Israelites, the Jews, together as they would believe that he was the true Son. He alone can light men into the knowledge and the presence of God. The Apostle Paul, that's why he wrote in Hebrews 1:3, he said that he is the radiance of his glory, meaning God's glory, in the exact representation of his nature. And upholds all things by the word of his power. And we had made the purifications of sins. He sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus said, my work was finished. And he went to be with his Father. The Apostle John, the light, refers many times in his writings in the Gospels, specifically to eternal life, to life everlasting. Is all available through Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. He came as a light into the world, and any man who follows him shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. The lights of Hanukkah related to the temple until its dedication. But there will also be lights, and they would do as in the feast, they said that tradition said that they would even in the time would light and put it outside and would have a cover over it so that people could see the lights. And there was a thing I read about the collection of oral laws of Rabbi Judah. And he said that in year 135 years after the death of Christ, that outside the entrance of every home, the Hanukkah lamp was positioned firmly for the Hanukkah miracle. The lamps were inserted into kind of a lantern type of thing to keep them from the wind, but they wanted to shine and show the light that they was able to the miracle that took place. Archaeologists, they say, have excavations and that they show that these things were common in that time period. We see the pedestal that Luke talks about, 11:33. Saying that after the lighting of the lamp, you know, don't put it away in the cellar. Don't put it under the bushel. Put it out for people to display. We say that we have Christ in us, the light of glory, and that light shines through us. And so we, too, are able to walk as lights to the Lord, and that he uses us to be a light in this world. And in a sense, when the light comes into the darkness, we're there to shine Christ and let all his glory be seen through us. In John 3:19-21, there's a tragic consequence for those who reject the light. It says, this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world. The men love the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come to the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But he who practices the truth comes to the light so that his deeds may be manifested and as having been wrought in God. The last book of the New Testament, Revelation, Revelation 21:23. It says, all believers in the Messiah Jesus, both Jewish and Gentiles, will dwell forever with him in the city of eternal lights. Excuse me. This is what it will be like. It says, and the city has no need for the sun and the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God has illuminated it, and the lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring glory to it. In the daytime, for there will be no night there, its gates will never be closed. In Revelation 22:16, it says about the presence of the bright morning star. It says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root of the descendant of David, the bright and the morning star. God brought a great deliverance through Maccabees over 21,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago, as he performed even a greater work when Jesus followed that with a great deliverance for the world and defeated the powers of darkness. One Hebrew stated it this way. He says, I see that Jesus, our Messiah, the Son of God, he must be, for he came the very time of our Moses, said that he would come in Genesis 49. He came of the very tribe of Moses foretold in Genesis. He says he came the very way our great Isaiah said he would come, by the way of a virgin's womb. And they said that he was born in the very city that Micah predicted, Bethlehem. He says, yes, now I see that he is the one whom our Isaiah wrote in the 53rd chapter. All who come to the light and believe in Yeshua and find their darkness dispelled and their sins forgiven, Jesus becomes the light of their life. One of the scriptures that is used at the time of the lighting of the candles is Zechariah 4:6. It says that not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. The vision that God gave Zechariah in the 6th century B.C. was a never-changing vision, and it still reaches us today. And that vision has established the worship of God. Are you a worshiper of God? It encourages the witness to God, to be a witness for him, for all his glory alone to every generation. The goal can only be achieved by God's power of his spirit living in us and through us and coming upon us. We can still carry the torch and the light for our Lord Jesus Christ. And he uses you and I, and we become the miracle for somebody else. Have you ever had that opportunity to be able to share Christ with somebody and see the light turn on in them as they accept Jesus as their Savior? It's one of the best gifts that you can ever give in this season, is to give somebody the reason of the season, that Jesus came to give life and forgiveness of sins. There's no greater feeling to be able to see someone change their whole life around and become a follower of our Lord. One of the problems that we encounter is that in the scripture, it says, this is the word of the Lord, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Who are you, O great mountain? We can't pursue, and here's a warning or a problem that encounters us, is that we cannot pursue God's eternal purpose, become kind of his, to help get his kingdom to expand, to be able to bring Jesus out to the world without encountering a great mountain. All hell will be loosed against us as we walk in the light. The darkness can't stand the light. The more you shine, the more you'll see trouble and sometimes issues come your way. But as God shows us in his word, we see that as the Israelites started to walk through, and Ezra talks about the rebuilding of the wall, and they were given this great promise and a great hope, and they went to rebuild the wall, but they came against people that were trying to make them compromise. In Ezra 3, they had great discouragement. And in Ezra 4, they fell into unbelief, that they just couldn't get the job done. And if I look at today and Christ comes into our life, he wants us to continue in building the kingdom of God. But at times we become discouraged. At times we come to a time of compromise. And we compromise what we think is right and wrong. And we know what is right, but we compromise that because the easy road is always the wrong road. And then we fall sometimes in unbelief when things happen to us. And we start saying, why me, God? Well, what have I ever, like that old song, what have I ever done to deserve this? But I want to encourage you today that if we put our hope in the Lord and we don't do it in our strength, but it says that that not by might, not by our own strength, but by my spirit. And when we're able to lead with God's spirit as the Lord of hosts, it's his empowering it that makes it happen. And we give him the glory for that. You might be sitting there saying, well, who am I? I don't have any talents. I don't have any abilities. In Zechariah 4:10, he talks about, for who is despised the day of small things? Little is much when God is in it. I'm kind of paraphrasing this. But don't despise the things that you're doing. You might say, well, you know, I'm a housewife. I have my family. I have all this stuff going. It's like, it's the little things that you do every day, what you're teaching your children. You might say, well, I'm stuck in a cubicle in an office and I don't get out much. I don't have much of a life. It's what you're doing in that little cubicle to be able to give glory to God. You might say, well, I'm going to school and I'm a student and I'm just too young to really know what even God wants to do with my life. I says, be faithful in the small things. Be faithful in the believing of God in your life, in the small things. Because God says little is much when God is in it. So the little things you see, realize that God recognizes the little things. There's an old song we used to sing when we did camp, and it says, little by little, every day, little by little, in every way, Jesus is changing me. And since I made a turnabout face, I've been growing in God's grace because Jesus, he's changing me. Is Jesus changing you? Little by little every day, little by little in every way, Jesus is changing you. I'm so glad that I have a Savior that loves me and cares for me. And he promises that he'll enlighten us in the things. It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. We must not also fall into our flesh. Our tendency is to fall just on our own strength and our own nature and our own pulling it through. And we've just got to be able to rely on the Lord of hosts, to rely on the Spirit. Only when we are filled with the Spirit and anointed by the Holy Spirit, anointed by God, that mountains become plain. Mountains get leveled in our life. The giants of the land don't seem so big anymore because we have a different perspective. They're still going to be there, folks. You're still going to have giants, and you're still going to have mountains to cross. But when the Lord comes into your life and you're led by the Holy Spirit, they just don't seem, they seem to be manageable. I can do it. I can take this step today and I can conquer it. So today I want to encourage you that you'll be the living, you'll be the loving light that can reach and touch the world around you. Your world, your area of who you're involved with, your area to how you can touch people. I can't touch people that you touch. You're in a whole different circle than I'm in. But we together as the body, we become God's kingdom and God's kingdom worker. I want to encourage you to just allow yourself to be used and say, Lord, I want to see the power of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, give me the opportunity to be able to share. Give me the opportunity to be able to give. Give me the opportunity to be able to serve somewhere, somebody. Give me the opportunity to not be so wrapped up in myself that I can be wrapped up in other people. Would you this Christmas look for ways that you can become a servant? Jesus said, if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, what? Become the servant of all, didn't he? So let us stand in a word of prayer. Hi, I'm Pastor John McConnell, and I'd like to welcome you today for watching our program. It's just amazing the technology we have today that we're able to live stream all around the world. And we'd like to give you an opportunity, if you'd like to give towards this ministry, you can go online and be able to follow the directions that are on there and be able to give to the ministry that you've been watching. So God bless you. We thank you for being part of Southside Alliance Church today.